prefixes that branch of philosophy that is primarily interested in questions concerning appropriate human behavior. At its most basic, ethics or moral philosophy is concerned with what is morally right and wrong and how people can distinguish between the two. The term ethics and ethical are derived from Greek word ethos, which originally meant customs, usages, especially those belonging to some group as distinguished from another, and later came to mean disposition or character. They are thus like the Latin word moral from moris, or the German sittlich from sitten. It was in customs or ethos or moris that the moral or ethical began to appear. Ethics or moral philosophy asks basic questions about the good life, about what is better and worse, about whether there is any objective right and wrong, and how we know it, if there is. Ethics is not a manual with answers on how to act. It is only a search for the right kind of morality. Ethics is the explicit philosophical reflection on moral beliefs and practices. The difference between ethics and morality is similar to the difference between musicology and music. Ethics is conscious stepping back and reflecting on morality, just as musicology is conscious reflection on music. Morality pertains to the first-order beliefs and practices about good and evil by means of which we guide our behavior. In contrast, ethics, the second order, is reflective consideration of our moral beliefs and practices. Ethics is commonly grouped into three branches: descriptive, normative, meta-ethics. Descriptive ethics is concerned with the way things are, with the existing standards of morality. It deals with facts. It describes and explains what our process for ethical deliberation actually is. Descriptive judgments are therefore true or false. Normative ethics, on the other hand, is the study of what constitutes conduct that is morally right or wrong. It treats of how persons ought to conduct themselves, not how they do. It is prescriptive in that it attempts to explain what our approach to moral problems ought to be. Normative judgments, therefore, are value judgments in that they indicate whether something is good or bad, right or wrong. Normative ethics is so called because it involves norms or standards or criteria for judging the moral rightness or wrongness of conduct. Normative ethics can be divided into two parts: general normative ethics and applied normative ethics. In general normative ethics, a set of principles that prescribe right moral conduct is generated and justified as valid. When ethics is talked about in a common sense, then we are talking about this general normative ethics. When inquiry is directed towards the principles of moral judgment or the criteria for the ethical analysis of morality, then we talk about fundamental ethics. Since theory consists of a set of principles, general normative ethics is also called ethical theory. On the other hand, applied normative ethics is the study of how ethical principles should guide conduct in specific contexts. Normative theories are applied to specific controversial moral issues like animal rights, abortion, euthanasia, academic freedom, press freedom, generating the classic so-called hyphen ethics, for example, bioethics, medical ethics, business ethics, media ethics. Meta-ethics is the study of the meaning of terms used in ethical principles and the forms of arguments used to justify ethical principles. Meta-ethics is considered non-substantive, while normative ethics is considered substantive. Meta-ethics does not address conduct as normative ethics does. It addresses instead ethical theory. Thus, meta-ethics addresses knowledge, while normative ethics addresses practice. Meta-ethics is second-order discourse or discourse about mention, while normative ethics is first-order discourse or discourse about use. For example, meta-ethics addresses the question, What does it mean that capital punishment is right? While normative ethics addresses the question, is capital punishment right? In normative ethics, there are different theories as to how criteria of moral conduct should be defined. The three main theories are virtue, deontological, and teleological ethics. Virtue ethics, the oldest theory dating back to the ancient Greek, is not about rules and obligations, but rather about the sort of person one is. To Aristotle, the ethical life is about developing one's character to become the right sort of person.
Is it my advice to you? I know you think these guys are your friends.
If you want to be a true friend to them, be honest.
Virtue ethics is a view that focuses on moral character and dispositions or traits that promote human flourishing.
Logic? A tomato can't move!
That's what I said! So if he can't move, how's he gonna sit down, George? I was a stand-up tomato, a juicy, sexy beefsteak tomato! Nobody does vegetables like me! I did an evening of vegetables off Broadway! I did the best tomato, the best cucumber! I did an endive salad that knocked the critics on their ass!
Virtues do not involve specific actions like telling the truth, as much as they represent a person's long-standing practices that are consistent with an ideal, like being an honest person. This approach to ethics begins with a consideration of what it means to live a good life and what the goal of life might be. Traditionally, virtues such as courage, temperance, justice, and wisdom are viewed as important character traits to develop in the process of becoming a moral person and ultimately finding the happiness or fulfillment.
You go. Where shall I go? What shall I do?
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
This is a very important decision you're making, Staros.
But if you feel that strongly, maybe you have a reason, so I'm coming down.
Virtue ethicists do not typically discuss universal rules to guide conduct, but rather universal character traits that should be developed in order to handle such situations when they arise.
You're leaving me because you believe that you don't deserve happiness, but you do, Anna. Did you have a boss because you had sex with him? So you wouldn't smell of him? So you'd feel less guilty? How do you feel?
Aristotle's virtue ethics is largely concerned with the question of what promotes human happiness or flourishing, about what leads to a fuller and happier human life or eudaimonia.
It was clear to me. That sound I had heard in the Archbishop's palace. Here again was the very voice of God.
Virtues are those traits or excellences of character that promote human flourishing, whereas vices are those weaknesses of character that impede human flourishing.
Astounding. It was beyond belief. First and only drafts of music. But they showed no corrections of any kind. Not one.
Und ich habe 3 Jahre auf dem Konservatorium studiert, aber es hat nicht gelangt.
Human flourishing is defined in terms of reasoning or thinking, ultimately in terms of the contemplative life.
You don't understand. I could have had class. I could have have been a contender. I could have been somebody. Instead of a bum.
I guess I could be pretty pissed off about what happened to me. But it's hard to stay mad when there's so much beauty in the world. Sometimes I feel like I'm seeing it all at once, and it's too much. My heart fills up like a balloon that's about to burst. And then I remember to relax and stop trying to hold on to it. And then it flows through me like rain, and I can't feel anything but gratitude. No idea what I'm talking about, I'm sure. But don't worry. You will someday.
From Greek word deon, meaning that which is necessary or binding, deontological theory is based on the notion of choosing one's actions according to standards of duty or obligation that refer not to consequences but to the nature of actions and the motives that are held by those performing them. Deontology is the view that the moral status of an action should be evaluated based on qualities of the action, independent of its consequences.
What's your legal excuse for killing Barney Quill?
Not justification.
Not justification.
Just excuse.
Well, what excuses are there?
How should I know? You're the one that plugged Quill.
I must have been mad.
How's that?
I said I must have been mad.
Well, bad temper's no excuse.
Yes, ma'am.
Do I take responsibility for both of their deaths?
Yes, ma'am. With my stem on Taylor, not
While deontology acknowledges that the consequences of an act are relevant for determining its moral status, considerations of moral rules outweigh considerations of the goodness of consequences. Deontologists suggest that a person's rational faculties are capable of apprehending these ethical obligations. On this view of ethics, one has certain moral duties or obligations, and he or she must fulfill them to act ethically.
We will not live by your commandments, we are free!
The focus of this approach is not about character nor the consequences of an act, but the principles upon which a person acts. Moral acts are not regarded as good or bad based on their outcome, but rather the state of mind or intentions of the person in question.
I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody.
everything must go.
Even if we could do it, you have to be a match for him.
Let me save a life before I go. It's the least I can do.
So you really expect me to believe that you want to do this for a kid?
Whatever helps you sleep at night, Dr. Gray.
One of the key assumptions of the ontological moral theory is that people cannot always predict or control the consequences of their actions, but that they do have control over their intentions. Since people can only be held morally responsible for and judged on actions that they can control, the deontologists focus on intentions of moral agents rather than on outcomes. In Sophie's Choice, is the mother justified in giving up one of her two children to save lives? For most deontologists, Immanuel Kant's ethical theory rests on three central insights. The first two of these insights state the conditions for a morally good act. First, an action has moral worth if it is done for the sake of duty. An act's moral worth depends on the reason for which it is done. It is not enough that an act conforms to duty. It must also be done for the sake of duty. It must be done out of a concern for what is morally right, not out of some self-serving motive. Second, an action is morally correct if its maxim can be wielded as a universal law, so-called universalizability. One of our basic intuitions in the moral life centers around the belief that what is fair for one is fair for all. Part of Kant's insight into morality is that it is equally applicable to everyone. Kant calls his basic moral principle categorical imperative. It is imperative because it tells us to do something. It gives us command. It is categorical because it is unconditional.
Do it. What do you want me not to do? Not to meet with Mr. Jinnah? I am a Muslim and a Hindu and a Christian and a Jew and so are all of you.
I promise you, until you do right by me, everything you think about is gonna crumble. You do it, Miss C. Trade places. What would I have been doing?
And third, we should always treat humanity, whether in ourselves or other people, always as an end in itself and never merely as a means to an end. So-called respect.
You can't go.
What's the check?
Over there. To your left.
I know you don't think I'm giving this $4 million to a bunch of nuns.
Kant's directive prescribes an attitude of respect towards ourselves as well as toward other people. The imperative tells us how to act, not how to feel. This is particularly relevant in understanding respect, for we need to ask whether respect is just way of acting or whether it also involves feeling a particular way.
I think you're wonderful, Otome.
Tom Robbins, a human being.
Respect is directed only toward persons and is related only to one aspect of persons, their rationality. According to Kant, what we respect in other people is their ability to reason and on the basis of their reason to choose to act in particular ways. While we respect reason and will in human beings, we apparently have no direct duty to respect their feelings. To Kant, emotions are fickle, and a moral lie based on emotions would lack the reliability of one based on reason. The subject of respect is an acting subject, not a feeling subject. the object of respect and the other person, including the self, is primarily reason and will and not feeling. Consequentialist or teleological theories from the Greek telos, meaning aim or purpose, and logos, meaning truth, is based on the notion of choosing one's actions so as to maximize the value or values to be expected as consequences of those actions. Teleological theories hold that an action is morally right either if a person's doing it brings about the best attainable consequences in the situation, or if the action is of a kind which would have the best attainable consequences if everyone did it in that sort of situation. It is the goodness or badness of the consequences of actions alone that make them right or wrong, rather than anything intrinsically good or bad about the actions themselves. Thus, there would be no universal moral prohibition against deliberately killing another human if so doing would produce a greater balance of good over evil than any other course of action open at that time. The teleological or utilitarian theory asserts that the basis for ascribing right or wrong act rests solely on the consequences, the benefits versus harm of the act. Cultures clash, and what they do, we must decide how to deal with the resulting conflict. Unknowingly, at times, we hold on to three ethical positions. Ethical absolutism maintains that there is a single standard in terms of assessment that can be made, and that standard is usually their own. In a clash of cultures, they often see the other culture as simply wrong insofar as it deviates or different from their own. Ethical absolutists maintain that there is a single moral truth in terms of which all cultures and individuals are to be judged. This absolute moral standard usually happens to coincide with the absolutist's own personal beliefs. Ethical relativism sees each culture as an island unto itself, right in its own world, and they deny that there is any overarching standard in terms of which conflicting cultures can be judged. Ethical relativists would say that each culture is right unto itself, so such practices would be morally permissible in some countries and morally wrong in some other countries. Ethical pluralism acknowledges that cultures can legitimately pass judgments on one another and encourages us to listen to what other cultures say about us as well as what we say about them. In addition, it encourages toleration when possible, recognizing that cultures may legitimately differ even on the most important issues. Ethical pluralists attempt to find some middle ground in two ways. First, unlike both absolutists and relativists, ethical pluralists would be interested in looking at the practices in our own culture that may raise similar questions. The difference between the pluralist and the absolutist is that the pluralist is much less likely to assume a holier-than-thou attitude, less likely to use examples such as this just to acquire the moral high ground. Second, ethical pluralists may well be open to examine the goals of the practice, and if those goals appear legitimate, explore other ways in which they could be attained without the associated harms of the practice. Whether there are such legitimate goals in this case remains unclear. Humans are rational Homo sapiens and reflective Homo sapiens beings.
Fasten your seatbelts. It's going to be a bumpy night.
Humans have intelligence and freedom to determine the nature of his or her acts, as well as the consequences of these acts. Ethical norms guide humans how to use these intelligence and freedom in making decisions towards certain acts, about what or when or where to say or write or do, or what or where or when not to say or write or do. Ethical or moral norms indicate human beings' rights, duties, and obligations toward himself or herself and other sentient beings. Without these norms, humans are beasts. Lost. Devouring. Devoured. In the wilderness.